This series is really designed to bring some of the thought leaders to campus, have them share with us their perspective on the world by looking perhaps sometimes into the past, by spending some time with future opportunities, and then by gazing into the future to make sure that we see as much as they see, so that we as a university community are appropriately preparing you to get out there and do what? Grow the future and lead the world. And so tonight, we really are absolutely thrilled to have these two corporate leaders with us. And I'll just say a word or two about each one. I'm not going to read their bios. You have that in your packet. But first of all, I do want to welcome to Morgan State University, to my far right, Ms. Maxine Williams from Facebook. And so many of you know that Maxine is the Global Director of Diversity at Facebook, and she has a very impressive pedigree. She attended Yale University, where she received her law degree with honors from there, from Oxford University, where she was a Rhodes Scholar. And so you will hear more about her. I'm going to ask her when I introduce the next speaker, both of them, to say a little bit more about their backgrounds and how they ended up where they are. And hopefully you can then glean some things from what they share with us about their trek. I do want to say, though, that I shared with Maxine a few minutes ago that she and I had an opportunity about, 3 years ago to warm each other's hands because I was out on the campus of Facebook, and they put on a presidential summit there and asked myself and the then president at Spelman College, Beverly Tatum, and the president of Clark Atlanta University to come and kind of be on a panel to talk about some of the same issues we're talking about tonight. And so little did I know that we would officially be having you here at Morgan, but welcome.
Thank you.
Second, we are absolutely delighted as well to have with us Ms. Yolanda Mangalini.
It's a mouthful.
And Yolanda is the Director of Global Diversity at Google. And she has been at Google for 11 years. And before that, she had a very impressive career in the banking industry. And she, too, has an incredibly impressive academic background and pedigree. She holds a Bachelor of Arts degree, summa cum laude, and Phi Beta Kappa from Villanova University, from the Honors Program in Economics. And then, of course, an MBA from the Stanford Graduate School. And so please join me in giving a warm Morgan State University round of welcome to Maxine and Yolanda. So, Maxine, can you take a few minutes and just kind of share with the audience any aspect of your background and career
sure.
at this point that you would like to?
Sure. First, I want to say that it is fantastic to be here. Thank you very much for having me. We have a few Facebook people in the crowd who are looking forward to meeting all the students. And it's funny to hear you talk about pedigree, because I never use that word anymore since I applied a few years ago, not long ago, for a job in a nonprofit. And the young man looked at my resume and he said, "I'm sorry, you don't have the pedigree for us." And I realized then, like, how relative it is, you know? It really just depends on what you want to do, because all that Yale and Oxford and Rhodes Scholar, he was like, "This is not adding up to much for me." And now, look at that. Like, I got rejected from that job, and I ended up at Facebook. So you see, as we say in the Caribbean, what is for you is for you. You know, right? So how I ended up here is because I got rejected from another job. And I'm thankful for that. I spent some years doing human rights work, some years as a practicing lawyer, doing a lot of work with unions, so on workers' rights. I have taught law at the University of the West Indies, I've done a whole other career in media, and I think that's another lesson that I have learned is that, you know, you do whatever you need to do, the things that make you happy, the things that fulfill you. We say at Facebook that we want people to do what gives them strength. And from that, it will take you where you need to go. So there is no one path. As a diversity person, now I often get people saying, how do I get into diversity? How do I get into diversity? And 10 years ago, when I got into diversity, it wasn't a big thing. And it's becoming more of a thing now. And maybe then there will become dedicated paths to it. But for me, it was a constant interest in social justice, which led me here and which led me to all of the other choices that I made. So I am pleased to sit here today and, you know, to speak to you about the things that you are particularly interested in. The subject of diversity is one that both Yolanda and I are, you know, we spend our lives thinking about that, because diversity is at this moment the thing that we use as that focus of our attention on justice to get more opportunity for more people to share in the beauty and the magic of technology. I was, you know, I went to Facebook from, I was living in New York and I was at a law firm and I was not at all, I didn't know anything about the tech industry. As I said, like, you know, there's also an East Coast, West Coast divide where when you're in Silicon Valley, you're sort of very aware of, oh my gosh, look at how this thing is changing the world, right? All of the products that are being created. And when you're on the East Coast, you're like, oh, it's a good thing my phone is working. Right? As long as my phone is working, I'm already thinking about what's going on behind that. But it has been now a wonderful thing for me to experience the magic that is happening. And I want to give everybody the opportunity to share in that and to help us build better products, to help us build products that will help the world. You know, at Facebook, our mission is to connect the world, because we believe that to connect the world is to connect for the better. And I know that we can do that even more, even better, if we have more diversity in our ranks as we serve the world.
Okay, very good. And so, Yolanda, what about your track?
Yeah, so as Dr. Wilson said, I've been at Google for 11 years, but I never did diversity or HR before I came to Google. I started my career in investment banking and was a financial analyst, and so did IPOs and mergers and acquisitions before I went off and got my MBA. And then I was a principal at the Boston Consulting Group. So I was there for 6 years and then did strategy for a bank after that. So my roots are much more in business strategy. And so if you had told me 11 years ago that I'd be in HR, I would tell you, you're kidding. Like, there's no way I'd do that. When I joined Google, Google was about 5,000 people. And there were lots of things. It was at an inflection point, right? We were at a period in our growth where we needed to start thinking about more carefully about people processes. I remember I did the very first recruiting analysis, expense analysis for a senior vice president. And which amazed me, like, how can these people not know what we spend on recruiting? But Google was about trying to change the world. Like, our mission is to organize the world's information and make it universally useful and accessible. And I think it's actually telling for you all that both Maxine and I know our mission, and it's because both of our companies organize around that, right? It every single Googler will know what our mission is. But I kind of fell into the diversity and inclusion work. And I think what attracted me to it was the focus on sort of on equity and just an inherent understanding that without diverse perspectives, you can't succeed. You can't innovate, right? There's been lots of research, Scott Page from the University of Michigan, who have shown that diverse teams produce better outcomes, right? They are faster at problem solving, better at innovation. And if I think about what Google's mission is, we can't deliver on that unless we have diverse teams. And unless we have a culture that embraces diversity. When I think about, you know, technology, I think why I've been at Google, this is the longest place I've ever worked, I think about technology as being the great equalizer. Like, I think about YouTube. And who was it? My son was, I have an 11-year-old son, and he was telling me about this YouTuber who makes like millions of dollars a year. He videotapes himself like playing video games or something. And this is, I mean, literally that's what he does. And somehow he's made a business out of it. But I think about the doors that technology can open for you, whether it's through YouTube or some of the things that we do on my team, working with small and medium, minority and small and medium businesses and helping them to grow online. And it's just incredibly gratifying to be in this space. And so it's been exciting. It's hard work. What we're talking about at the end of the day is behavior change and attitude change. But it's incredibly gratifying. You see the light bulb go off in someone's head.
Fascinating. So I'm going to ask the first question, and then we have microphones, I believe, here. And so you did not come to hear me. We want to get to you as quickly as possible. But let me sort of open the first question this way. Reverend Jesse Jackson has been sponsoring for a few years something called the Wall Street Project. And 2 years ago, it was held in the Silicon Valley, and he asked me to be one of the HBCU presidents to appear on a panel out there. And so he opened the panel by challenging the tech firms to think about diversity and inclusion very differently than they perhaps had been thinking about it. And he used an analogy, and I'll quickly use the analogy and then kind of ask you, how are Facebook and Google, quote unquote, looking at the entire field? And so here's the analogy he used. He said, you know, I use a sports analogy he did. He said, if you had a quarterback on a team, and you basically put a piece of tape over one of his eyes, and you told him, okay, I want you to have a 90% completion rate, and I want you to throw 6 touchdowns in the game, but you can only look at half the field. And how challenging that would be, because the quarterback is not looking at the entire field. And so he was using that analogy to say that perhaps the tech industries are not looking at the entire field of talent, but was perhaps looking at talent coming out of the Ivy League institutions or the MITs and the Stanfords, when they really should be looking at the entire field and looking at HBCUs and those institutions that are disproportionately producing the engineers and the computer scientists and those innovators. So with that, I do know that both Google and Facebook have been making significant entrees in the last couple of years or so to ensure that the talent that you recruit and retain will be diverse. And so can you share with us some of the strategies that you are now employing to make sure that you are, that your companies are looking at the entire field and not just half of it?
Yeah, there's a couple of things. Oh, I'll start, if you don't mind, Maxine. There are a couple of things that we've done on the Google side. I mean, I would say that we actually acknowledge that part of the reason why Google looks the way we look is because we tended to recruit from selective universities, particularly at the undergraduate level, or even for industry hiring, right? When you look at someone's resume, where do they go to school? And we know that they aren't particularly diverse. And so if I took the technical pipeline as an example, we know that 30% of bachelors of computer science come from HBCUs, right? So there's no way that you can't recruit from an HBCU. So several years ago, we started to come here. In parallel, we started to do some analysis, and I actually think one of my colleagues might have been here that I see in the audience might have been at Google when we did this analysis, where we looked at it was like the top 1,000 schools for computer science. And then we did a really deep dive audit around the kinds of computer science classes that were taken, because as Maxine can attest to, we look for people who have good CS fundamentals, understand algorithms and data structures. It's a very specific kind of computer science. And then we overlaid in that analysis the diversity of the student body. And what happened was there were a lot of colleges that we'd never been at before that bubbled to the top, and we've more than tripled the number of colleges that we recruit from, right? And the other thing that we do is talk to hiring managers, and we hire by committee, and train them on unconscious bias and talk to them around taking a broader view of the profile and using structured interview to test skills rather than using a resume to make a decision. I have a fellow on my team who didn't graduate from college, but it doesn't matter that he didn't graduate from college, because he had during the interview, we tested the skills that we needed to do. So I think that's, those are some of the ways that Google has been trying to do that.
I would say that, well, two things. One is that when people speak about tech, it's not the same at every company. So, you know, what Google is doing may not be what even, you know, people compare Google and Facebook, but, you know, we are, I don't know, a quarter of your size. And then there are startups in the industry, and then there are older companies in the industry, and there's some companies that are doing more hardware, and there are others that are doing software. And so for every company, you do that analysis around what are the skills that we are looking for, and then where are the people who have those skills. So that overlay is important. At Facebook, we recruit from about 300 colleges in this country, right? So it is a broad swath. In the last week, I have met with the president of Howard, the dean of the College of Engineering at Morgan, North Carolina A&T, and then I'm here today, right? We are doing a lot of work around the breadth and then looking for the depth in it. So the precision around the type of skills we need is where it becomes tricky. That's the tricky part. I don't think that there is any longer, and in fact, in this industry, you know, I've come from different industries, and I can say that in the tech industry is where I've seen the least preference for where you went to school versus what you know. You know, you talk about there's somebody on your team who doesn't have a degree. My CEO doesn't have a degree.
Oh, that's right. That's right. I didn't think about that.
Like, that's not a priority for us. The priority for us is what do you know? And luckily in tech, you can acquire those skills. A lot of it is going beyond the books, right? This is why there are hackathons, and this is why there are boot camps, and this is why there are all these meetups, right? And innovation labs and maker spaces. It's about what are you building, right? So we are downloading all these apps. What are we uploading? And acquiring those skills, luckily, in fact, some of it is aided by the fact that you now have things like Facebook groups, right? Like you have the internet. You have places you can find other people who are interested in this where you can acquire those skills. So for us, we've broadened by the number of schools that we recruit at. We do have these relationships now, not just with HBCUs, but HSIs as well. And then we've done a lot of work around trying to make it more obvious to people what we want. So we built something called Tech Prep, which is available to everybody, where it's called techprep.fb.com, where we sort of give a guide to here are the jobs in the industry, and here is how long it takes to like study for that, but also here's what you would earn, and PS, put in your zip code, and then it will tell you where near to you you can start acquiring coding skills. So a lot of it is just making it more clear to people what we need, what we're looking for, and then if you can find a way to learn those skills, that is what I have seen is most valued.
Great perspectives. And so why don't we go to the microphones? So for those of you who would like to ask questions, you make your way to the microphones. And I do see anyone, questions from the audience. Okay, someone is making their way down. Okay. So we have microphones here on both sides of the auditorium. And if you would make your way down, and we'll get to your question. So if you would identify yourself, your major, and your classification here at Morgan, and then ask your question.
Check, check.
Okay, so why don't we go here first, and then we'll...
ladies
here?
First.
Oh, okay. Hi, my name is Sheena Williams. I'm a business administration major and a political science minor. I'm also a university innovation fellow. So my question is, being that I am a business major, how do students across disciplines get involved in the tech industry?
And the reality is that there are jobs in finance and marketing and sales that aren't technical, right? So Google is half engineers, but so we're about 62,000 people. So that's like 31,000 other jobs that you don't need a technical degree from. So I would ask you sort of, are there particular areas that are interesting to you? Do you like finance? Are you interested in HR, like people operations? I think about my work. The work that we do in some of our sales group, and it could be frontline sales versus, or it could be sort of customer service. And so think about the kinds of things that sort of give you energy, but there are, we tend to talk a lot about like the tech side when I'm out there, but there are any number of jobs that don't require a technical degree at all that are really sort of business focused.
I don't know if you want for time for us to just go, you know, not both of us answer every question. I don't know what's the preference for you.
Okay, if you would like to direct your question to either Maxine or Yolanda, you can indicate that. Otherwise, one response would be suffice, so we can get to as many as possible. So,
hi, I'm Io Cole. I'm actually not a student at Morgan. I'm here with some of my coworkers from Under Armour. So my question for you all is, you know, what have been some of the greatest challenges that you've seen in getting some people in your organization to buy into the idea of diversity as a way to drive business? And what have you found to be the most effective tactics or strategies to sort of get over that hump and get them to believe in the necessity of it?
So we're going to ask both of you to respond to that.
Okay. For us, I have to say that we have been very blessed that the concept of buy-in, which I know is a challenge in a lot of places, has not been as great a challenge. Now, part of the blessing is that I come from a company where Sheryl Sandberg is the COO, right? And so for years, she's laid that groundwork around opportunity and equality. And so some of that work was done. That said, the concept of cognitive diversity is one that we use and it has really resonated well for a population that is so focused on data, right? Understanding things in a particular way. And so explaining the value of diversity to them around the concept that they will build better products because we will have more diverse teams and more diverse teams come up with better solutions if you're trying to solve complex problems, not necessarily simple problems. But we know all the problems we're trying to solve are complex, right? Nobody's ever connected the whole world before. So it's a complex proposition. And once they understand that and see the value that it will bring us better results, more efficient, and it's like more innovation, right? They connect those dots and that's what they're driven by. And so I think for each company, you have to know your culture and know what inspires them, what drives them. For us, it's getting to that excellence of innovation. So knowing that diversity will help get there, you know, unlocks it all. Like you don't even have to say anymore. So we don't even use the same expressions I used to use in other industries. Like, you know, here's a business case. So we don't even need that because they get that, oh, this is going to get me better development, better creativity, better products, serve the world better, I'm in.
I would say, I mean, I would echo some of what Maxine said, but I'd also say, if I think about some of the challenges that we've had at Google, and I actually think this is probably a broader challenge within tech, but there tends to be this sort of myth of the meritocracy, right? That everything's sort of meritocratic. And therefore, if it's into the meritocracy, you don't need to do anything special, right? And I think over the years, I think our leaders have begun to understand that you actually have to be intentional. Like things don't happen by accident. Like if you weren't intentional about your recruiting, you will probably end up with a largely white and Asian workforce, which is what we have, right? But you need to be intentional about talent development. You need to be intentional about the talent that you bring into the organization. And I think, as you know, Maxine said, you know, these folks are data driven at the end of the day. So you have to show them the story using data. I'd say the other powerful tool for us has really been narrative and storytelling. And when some of our leaders who I've had a leader who's not from the US who says, you know, I'm European. I don't understand like all this race stuff, for example. And then when he sits and hears a story from the Black Googlers on his team about their experiences, particularly we did a vigil in the wake of a lot of the Black shootings last year, it sort of like opened his eyes and he realized, wow, there's actually systemic racism like at Google. And hearing the story is what made it click for him, right? And so I've been really heartened to see that power of narrative. We had, do you all know who Brian Stevenson is? Okay, so he came and gave a talk at the end of during our Black History Month. And he was talking about the work that he does and he was sharing some of the stories. And I tell people, like jokingly, that he did more to create allies for the Black community, for people to hear his story, than anything else that I've seen. Like I had, no joke, probably 150 most non-Black people emailing me, telling me that was the best speech they, it was at our TGIF, which is where we get, the whole company gets together and you can ask the CEO any questions that you want to. It was the best sort of TGIF they had they had seen, right? And what could they do to help advance social and racial justice? And so it's this narrative piece, and you need to, it's about the heart and the mind, right? And so you need to attack both of them.
Okay, next.
Good evening. My name is Kushal Sharma, and I'm a junior finance major at Graves Honor Society at Morgan State University. And first of all, I would like to thank Ms. Williams and Ms. Mangolini for being here, and Dr. Wilson for inviting our guest. And today, my question is for both Ms. Williams and Ms. Mangolini. And Facebook and Google are dreams of for many who are looking for a better career, but there are like many expectations from their respected company while hiring a new employee. And you say you are like a based on diversity, right? So what are your expectations like when you are like recruiting new employees?
What are the expectations of our employees?
Yes, like a new, like a when you are hiring new employees, just like
of
us.
New employees. Mm-hmm. And you don't, do you mean expectations for hiring or once people get there?
Yes, like once like we get there.
Expectations and what, like you have to tell me more. What do you mean expectations around what?
So you said like based on diversity, right?
Yes.
And like a qualification or yes. like skills, like yeah. What kind of like a expectation you are looking from us? Like we are like a new
recruiter.
Oh,
the criteria for hiring then.
Uh-huh.
What are we looking for in the people we hire?
Yes.
Okay. Boy, it depends on the job you're going for. I mean, for us, you're in finance. So, I mean, we are hiring builders. We like people who like to build stuff, right? We also like people who question things. So no matter what field you're in, it could be finance, it could be legal, it could be business development, we want people who are learners and who are questioners. So it's never just about, okay, do this. I often say, like in some companies, they hire people and they tell them, here's your job, go do that. We hire people and we say, here's a problem to solve, go solve it. It's a very different kind of approach, right? So even if you're in finance, we're gonna say, here's a problem to solve, solve it. And so people who are creative and people who are not obsessed about themselves. And by that I say, I think when one is so obsessed with oneself that you are afraid of failing or you're afraid of admitting what you don't know, then you're not going to be the most creative. You're not in a learning mindset. You're not going to be a builder, right? You're looking to protect your job. We don't want that. We want to do things in an innovative way, and to do that, you have to be willing to take that risk to get beyond yourself, to like try things, to make mistakes. You're being thoughtful, but you're always pushing this boundary. So it's about being comfortable in that space where you're not just being told what to do, but you're being shown what needs to be, like, you know, here is the issue to solve. Can you come and help us and be part of this team to solve that?
Yeah, and for Google, I would say, We want people who are comfortable with ambiguity and can thrive in unstructured environments. I mean, similar to Facebook, people aren't going to like write out the list of things for you to do. And if you're one of those people that needs that structure, Google is not the place for you, right? We want people who get energized by solving like big hairy problems, and like aren't daunted by it, but actually are excited about it. And we want people who, when they see a problem, they'll take initiative to try and solve it themselves, right? Rather than looking for someone else to solve it for them.
So let me take a point of personal privilege here. While we're on this, can you say a word or two about the onboarding process for each of the companies?
Yeah,
so how do you actually go about the hiring process?
Yeah, the onboarding. So once you're hired, right?
Well, let's start with just the process for the hiring. You know, because the different stages and the technical aspects of that, you know, the assessment of the quote-unquote goodness of fit piece.
Okay.
How does all that come together where eventually it ends in an offer?
Okay, so it's a hiring process. How many people in this room are people who are studying computer science, computer engineering? So the minority. Okay. Because the hiring process is very different for the technical jobs, particularly software engineering is our big volume. Versus non-technical jobs. Because for the software engineering jobs, there will be a technical interview, right? And that involves solving problems with an interviewer where you're up on a whiteboard and you're given a problem solve, and you know what the interviewer is looking for is what is your thought process? How are you approaching this problem? So we've done something called Crush Your Coding Interview, where, again, trying to demystify what it is. We don't want to catch you out. We want you to know what are the types of things we'll be looking for, and so that you can prepare to come into that that interview knowing. You know, a lot of people come in and they think, this is a problem, I need to just give them the answer. When in fact, we want you to know that, no, we're looking to understand your thought process. So you're to speak to me throughout of it. Ask questions. I'm looking to see, are you asking smart questions, right? All of that is part of the evaluation process, because that tells me what kind of thinker you are and what kind of builder you are and how collaborative, because you'll be building with other people. So we want to see how are you interacting with this other person to get an answer to that problem. If you are in a non-technical role, then the interview process, I'm going to just sort of, even though obviously every role will be different, every function, but generally I can say that, you know, you'll see a job posted. We do post all of our jobs on our Facebook career site. So you should, if you're interested, you should be checking that site all the time. And then, I know, you apply. Let's say you apply blind, you get a call. You'll do a screening probably with a recruiter. You know, they're looking for basic qualifications. And if you meet those basic qualifications, then the recruiter will put you through to a first round on-site interview where you'll interview a couple of people, maybe the hiring manager and some other people who are looking for different aspects. So one might be looking to, somebody might be seeing, you know, does this person have the technical skills? And by technical, I don't mean coding in this sense, right? I mean, if you're for a job in finance, like how good are they at finance, right? If you're a lawyer, like, you know, give me an idea of types of stuff you worked on and, you know, some maybe a hypothetical. We're looking for problem solving. So hypotheticals may come up throughout this whole process. And then somebody else might be looking to see, is this somebody like a collaborative and speed? Those are very important things for us. So somebody who says, oh, I know how to do it and I don't need to check with anybody else is probably somebody who's not going to send us good signal. Because we remember we're the place that always say, like, don't assume you know everything, right? We want to be testing every assumption. So that doesn't work well. We have deliberately said to people at Facebook, we don't want you to use the term culture fit in your reviews in an interview process. Because if you just say this person is not a culture fit, that allows bias to seep in a way that we don't want it ever to. Because I don't know what you mean by not a culture fit. I don't know if you mean that person is not like me. You know, that person didn't talk like me, right? I don't talk like nobody else at Facebook except the other Caribbean people there. that is not relevant. If, however, you say this person was not collaborative, this person didn't ask creative questions, this person took a very long time to understand the concept, and those things now send me a signal, right? This person was not comfortable with ambiguity. Those things are things which are relevant to who we are and to whether you might be a good fit or not, right? But just say not a culture fit, that doesn't, we don't want that in the feedback. But then once you've interviewed with people, everyone will submit feedback. That feedback will all be reviewed and then a decision will be made sometimes by committee, sometimes by the hiring manager about whether you should be invited back for a second round. It's not always the case that it's one or two rounds, right? It depends, again. And then, again, everybody on that loop. And it will surprise people sometimes. This is one of the things that I realize surprises people, that somebody who you are reporting to might be interviewing you for a job. Because we are, again, a very flat organization, right? Hierarchy is not really important to us. And so it is weird. You're like, wait, but wouldn't this I be this person's boss? So how come this person is now having a say on whether I get hired or not? That's just how we do it. Like, everybody has a say. So, you know, who's on your loop is a question of, like, who we think should weigh in, who we think would have a good sense of what would be a good person to fill this role. So that's a little bit. And then at the end of it, we review all of the feedback, and then a decision is made on whether we'll issue an offer.
Very instructive.
So the Google process isn't dramatically different. We'll have a phone screen or technical phone screen, depending on whether it's for a technical role. And then on-site interview, We did some research a couple years ago that shows that I think beyond like the fifth interview, it adds very little incremental value. So we only, in general, you probably have four interviews. If you go above that, you need to serve an exception. And the way we think about the interview is we're looking at a couple of areas, something we call general cognitive ability, which is basically problem solving. And in that, you will get hypotheticals on the non-tech side. So it could be behavior-based hypotheticals, but hypothetical. And again, we want to see how you think. Then there's something around called role-related knowledge, which is really the specific skills for the job. Leadership. And then we've actually had this debate. We have something called googliness. But what we did was actually define what googliness meant, right? Mm-hmm. It's collaboration, it's comfort with ambiguity, it's passion for problem solving. And so because we definitely, we agree with sort of Maxine that there was the danger for bias around, like, I don't necessarily want people making a decision, do I want to spend time with this person? Because then you're going to choose someone like yourself, right? Mm-hmm. But so we wanted to put specific parameters around it. And then at Google, no one hiring manager makes a decision. It's always by committee. And the reason for that, and there's a great book that our former head of HR wrote called Rework, which has some more about our process in there, is that we want hiring managers are often can make decisions because they're pressured, right? They need to fill this role right away. And what we want is someone who's going to be good for Google, not just good for that role. And so we try and think about it really broadly. So there's a hiring committee that will make the yay or nay decision. So it doesn't matter that Yolanda, as a hiring manager, wants to hire this person. What matters is what the hiring committee thinks.
Okay, excellent. This side of the room.
Good evening. My name is Willie Smith. I'm a proud alumni of Morgan State University School of Engineering. I work for UPS as an IT project manager. I have two questions. Each one of you can answer each one apiece. So my first question is, I have a hard time convincing high-end managers, high-end committees that schools like Morgan are preparing the kids, the students, to be successful in the IT environment. What are some of the strategies and techniques that you're using to overcome managers who have a hard time believing that Morgan is preparing the students to the best of their ability? And the second question is, once you get those diverse minority students, what are some of the things you're doing to keep those students from leaving, going to other places?
I can't say that we have a hard time convincing hiring managers that Morgan students would make good employees. As I said before, they're not really focused on, that's not their driver, where you went to school. It's like, do you have the skill? So if you pass that technical screen and they see that you know how to do this problem solving, like, come, right? That's what we're focused on. Are you able to do that? So that is less of an issue. The second part of your question, which was around what do you do once they get there, we put a lot of effort into making sure we have an inclusive culture. And that means where you can come with your authentic self. We want people, this kind of openness that we talk about on the platform is also something that we have in our internal way of being, right? People should be able to be open, express yourself, right? The way you choose to express yourself, and then know you'll be supported. So we have a lot of, trainings, like we do the managing bias, and we have a bunch of other ones to help people navigate the process internally, help them learn how to have hard conversations internally, because that's a big thing, right? You might feel uncomfortable doing that. Well, here's how you do it. We also have employee resource groups, because we recognize that while an individual person might feel fine, like as a group, do you feel like I want to have support from people who look like me? I want a place that I can go where I can ask questions that I might feel stupid asking somewhere else, even though we tell you all the time, ask your questions. So the employee resource groups serve that function. And we equip those groups to support people. And then, there's a whole bunch of sort of downstream things where we build into the systems support. It may be through our HR business partners. It might be through, we do a lot of events sponsored internally where we bring people together. This Friday Q&A, which we have and which Google also has, is a place where the whole company is invited to come together and to share, to express, to question together. That's something which I think gives people this fabric that binds them, where they are all connected to something, right? And it brings us closer to the mission. And that connection, we hope, gives people a reason to stay. You know, by the time we hire you, you are somebody who could get hired anywhere you want to go. So when you talk about, you know, what do we do to make sure they don't go somewhere else, it's hard because competition is tight, right? All of this stuff we put you through, right? All of these, like, we want people collaborative and people who are problem solvers and people who have great technical skills and all of that. Like, okay, once you find those people, who wouldn't want them? Everybody wants them. And so no matter what, it's going to be hard. And especially in Silicon Valley, where like every day there's a new startup and a new idea and something popping up. There are a lot of jobs in Silicon Valley. So what you try to do is to create a place that kind of feels like home, that feels like family, and let people know you care about them as individuals and as people, and then you hope for the best.
Yolanda?
It's actually really
anything
similar.
Anything to add?
No, I don't think I think it's really, really similar how, in terms of how you think about it.
Okay, next.
Hello, so my name's Shavane Minto. I'm a sophomore CS major here at Morgan. And a lot of things that I hear from a lot of tech companies is the idea of diversity, bringing people of color into the company. But as one quote that I've recently heard is, diversity is inviting someone to the party. Inclusion is asking them to dance. So my question to the both of you is, it's one thing to bring people in, but what are you doing to make sure that their ideas, their point of views, the point of views of these different people of color are actually being heard?
I think that's a lot similar to that last question. I don't know if there's something you want to
add. I think of it as really similar in terms of, you know, how do we keep them here? And the slight difference I heard was, how do we make them feel like their voices are heard, right? One of the things that we look at Google is whether sort of managers and leaders are inviting and integrating diverse perspectives. And we have a kind of a way to sort of, you know, to measure that. But we also sort of make sure that there's a certain set of leadership behaviors that we're looking for with our leaders. And because we're looking at whether they're integrating and inviting diverse perspectives, we can actually point to them saying, you're not doing really well here, right? And you can make sure that they're focusing on that. But most people, I think, understand like the importance of hearing from a variety of people sort of in the room. And so I would say it hasn't been like a huge, huge problem.
Yeah. And we also do the same. We test whether people feel that diverse perspectives are being recognized on teams. When we teach people managing bias, we literally teach how to interrupt the interrupter. So here is what to do. If you notice there are people on these teams who are not getting their voices heard, here is how you be the ally. And you interrupt that as it's happening to give people the space to be heard. So all of that is woven into this thing about, you know, trying to create a community where you can really come and be yourself and be heard and have impact and value. Because there is no benefit to us, right? Think of all that we just described about the hiring process, how we're looking for talent, you know, hundreds of companies, hundreds of schools we're going to, the effort, the money, the time it takes to do that. It is of no benefit for us to hire you and then not take care of you. Yeah. Right? And then not have you be heard. The reason we want you there is because we want to hear from you. And so we then put these other things in place to make sure that we are hearing from you. I always say that bias is the thing that would rob cognitive diversity of its potential. Right? I don't want to believe that I can only hear from these people because then I'm not getting the benefit of these other people. And the reason we brought you here is because we want to hear from you. So we are invested in hearing from everyone and in receiving the impact, the value that everybody brings.
You know, some people are saying that we as a nation now are more divided than we have been in a while. And so I guess that's kind of follow up on the question. Are you seeing any evidence of what is happening outside of your corporate cultures, sort of seeping into the culture that you have been so careful over the years to perfect as this family? We care about you, we care about your ideas, we care about the way you think, and everything else is irrelevant?
No, I mean, nothing else is irrelevant. I mean, everything is relevant, right? Mm. People don't come to work and then leave the rest of themselves at home. Mm-hmm. So, and you know, the type of company that Facebook is a company that connects people. And so you come to work and you bring everything with you. And oh yeah. So it does seep in. And it just, you know, if you're in HR, the challenge is how do we support you as a whole person and still allow you and still create the conditions in which you can be productive? I think I can speak for Yolanda that, you know, it was very hard to get work done all of, I want to say like for 6 months of last year, from the time it became publicly visible at the volume it was happening, the violence against unarmed black people, it was very hard for people to come to work and just act like things were normal. And, you know, if you're in HR, you have to figure out, well, how do we do that? How do we allow people to still be productive, because they still want to be productive, but there are real things going on in society and in life that are impacting that ability. It's a kind of seamless situation, and we are learning how to be creative in that situation.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next.
You're going. Earlier, you were conveying to the audience that now in today's time, it's becoming less about where you graduated from and whether or not you have a degree, and more about the knowledge that you possess. So it's my question to you, like, as the economy is flooded with more and more individuals with degrees, what would you suggest doing to set myself apart from others? And what suggestions would you make to an individual trying to take risks and become a builder? And are there any other resources that you would point out besides the one you stated earlier, which was the
tech prep?
Yes.
I wasn't sure it was to you. You're talking about being a builder or not.
How can you differentiate yourself if everybody has a degree? It's by what you build. What are you doing? Like, you can have a degree and not do anything with it, but what are you doing and how are you thinking? And the one thing I would say is that, you know, I grew up in a time where, you know, we talked about education as a rote thing, right? Learn your times tables and just recite them back. We're not looking for those people. Those people will still have degrees, but are you an actual thinker? So that's the way you distinguish yourself.
I think the other thing I would add is Google's also looking for people who are like well-rounded and have, you know, have succeeded in sort of other areas. Like, I think about, there's a woman on my team a couple years back who was sort of amazing, but like on the side, she was a part-time choreographer for So Who You Think You Can Dance, and she was a great Bollywood dancer, and my colleague knows who I'm talking about, and so there was a passion and excitement for other areas of her life besides sort of academic. And you remembered her, right? When you saw that on her, you don't have to do crazy things like that, but think about the other places where you're sort of passionate. And people are going to remember those kinds of things. Like, there's like, I know sometimes we see Eagle Scouts or, think about what's interesting about you and don't be afraid to put that on your resume.
And we will ask about that, because we're just looking to see, like, who are you? Are you somebody who is creative? Are you somebody who's pushing boundaries? And so if you're pushing boundaries in your extracurricular activities, we're going to ask about that and value that. So that's what it's like, who are you? What are you doing in this world?
Okay, this side of the room.
Hi, my name is Nia Wood. I'm a junior marketing major here at Morgan. And I would like to thank you all for coming today. I truly appreciate you guys coming to talk to us. My first question is, if you were our age, what advice would you give us and why?
How you know I'm not your age?
They're not far from your age, right? That's a good comeback, Maxine.
I would think about not thinking about your career sort of too narrowly, right? Take risks. No risk, sort of no reward. And I probably would give myself that advice, because I'm sort of relatively conservative. Appreciate sort of your own sort of capabilities and don't underestimate like your own potential to be sort of great. And take that risk, right? Go for the thing that you think is so far out of your league, because it may not be, actually, right? Believe in yourself.
I think I would say to be more conscious of the finite nature of time. So once you're conscious of that, it starts to influence lots of decisions you make. So how you spend your time is so critical, right? Don't waste it. Why would you sit around like just watching TV for hours a day? Like, this is the only time you have, right? Do something with it. Learn something, produce something. Like, that's what's going to make it full. That's what's going to, all this talk about creative energy, problem solving. Like, the more you do, the more you're like out there living, the more you're going to be learning. And like, every day is a day to learn. So why waste a learning day?
Hey, why waste a learning day? That's a great takeaway. Someone needs to tweet that. Yes.
Or post it on Facebook. Thank you.
I'm told it's already on Facebook. And so
Instagram. Instagram is good,
and,
too.
In order to get to it, you'll have to Google it, right?
Okay, how you next. Guys doing? My name is Tahir. I'm a graduate student at School of Global Journalism. I'm also a grad assistant for the men's basketball team. My main question for you guys, I actually want to applaud you guys for being two beautiful black women doing what you're doing, but the issue of my question, I want to get to, as you look into the crowd, you see nothing but students here to listen to you. What about your lives, your personal lives, that could help them be more motivated? Like, what struggles did you go through to help them connect more with you? Because we can see you being head of Facebook and Google, but how can we connect with you more and relate to you more, or inspire us to push forward? As you can see, like, in our society now, we're facing a lot of things, you know, up against us, and it's hard for us to keep grinding through when we keep having these obstacles pushed against us, and it's hard for us to relate to you if we don't know nothing about your background to help us push even harder to become more powerful black women and black men. You know what I'm saying?
Whoa, so any aspects of your personal struggles you'd like to share?
Yeah. Oh, what you want to know about us?
Wrong question,
I mean,
right?
So much, like, I don't even know, like, what area. You never see, like, you see a person sitting in front of you, and there's 100 layers, right? So is it like the challenges we've had professionally? Is it challenges, you know, with parents, with partners, with children, right? Because every area has challenges to it. And all anybody's trying to do is get up every day, put one foot in front of the other, and do the best they can on that day. You know, Rihanna was just reminding me that I had written and posted my story about how I have a lot of rejection. So I talk about rejection from the nonprofit when I was rejected from the colleges that I had applied to, and how I got into Yale off of the wait list after they had waitlisted me. And I was like, what? And like, at every stage, you come up against these challenges. And what I have learned is that this thing about time and how you use it, my big thing is, until you nail that door shut, I'm going to keep pounding on that door. So until it's over, for real. Like, if I know it's over for real, then I'm not a crazy woman, right? I'll look for another door to try to open. But until it is completely shut. And so that has been in my professional life and my personal life, right? So I have two children, and everybody who works with me knows the challenges of working hard at work and then working hard at home. I always say, like, when I leave on a Friday afternoon and people go like, whoo, you know, you'll be seeing people in the office and be like, TGIF. And I was like, said the person with no children, because you do not know what I am about to go home and face here, right? Like, that weekend is harder than that week. And then within it, right, once you have children, like, there's all sorts of things. I have two black boys. So when I see what's going on in life, I'm like, Lord, how am I going to save them from this criminal justice system, right? I know these statistics. And so, like, every day you're working with these things weighing on you. But what can you do, right? You do your best. You bring excellence to what you're doing. You try to do it all. You forgive yourself a lot. I have to forgive myself when I know that, you know, oh, they did write about that meeting at school and I missed it, right? Because I had so many things going on that I didn't remember, or that I was supposed to pack $2 because it was pizza day and I didn't do it. And like, you know, you're going there, you're seeing the other parents looking at you like, and so like, I have failures all the time. Another one of the things we say at Facebook all the time is that done is better than perfect. And I carry that around and I know, you know what, I'm just trying to get some stuff done. I'll never do it perfectly. And I have to forgive myself for those things and try to do better next time. So whether it's personal or professional, the failures are there all the time, the challenges are there all the time. And we know, like, achieving perfection is not, you know, that you could try. And it's good to have a kind of goal in mind, but not to be obsessive about it such that you get destabilized or paralyzed when you don't meet that goal.
Mm-hmm. Yolanda?
I mean, I think, for me, I've had like a lot of failures in my life, things where things didn't go my way, and it was about learning from them. And I think about, I like what Maxine said around thinking about the concept of time. 4 years ago, I was diagnosed with cancer, and it reminded me of like tomorrow's never promised, right? And people, I think what I learned from that experience, I was out of work for about 8 months going through chemo and radiation, was that you can never give up, right? And I had my daughter was 5 at the time, my son was 7. And it never occurred to me that I was going to die, right? And I didn't think I was going to die. And even now, when I go back for my screens, like I'm not in this pessimistic sort of mind. It's like I tell people all the time, but the power of positive thinking. My infusion nurses told me I was the happiest cancer patient they ever had because I was always laughing. I laugh now. I'm known for my laugh at Google, and I still laugh during all of this. And you control your own destiny. And I could have chosen to sort of be beaten down and say, oh, I have cancer and I feel like crap. And or I could think, I actually thought about it, wow, I'm not working 70-hour weeks. I'm home with my kids. I get to spend more time with them. I was thinking about the bright side. But you can never give up, right? You always have to work. But I think about, like, that's the most recent sort of physical and personal challenge that I've had, but it still sits with me, right? Because I'm not considered cancer-free until next year, right? 5 years out. And so technically it can come back.
Hmm. Well, you control your own destiny. Mm-hmm. That's another tweetable outcome here. Thank you. You control. So we have time for 4 more questions, and I think we go over here to Mariko.
How you guys doing this evening? My name is Mariko Edwards II. I'm a junior business administration major here at Earl G. Graves Honors Program. And my question for you two ladies is, seeing that both of you work in diversity for two of the most socially dynamic companies created to this day, your companies have learned how to unleash employees' creativity to change the lives of billions. And so my question for you guys is, you know, in the, I guess, African-American community, how can we all be more confident and be more creatively confident to get to the goals that we are all trying to achieve? Because especially in the world we live in today, it is not as easy. And speaking on diversity and inclusion, these are kind of the ways that we are going about building this confidence. But what is some advice that you would give to the students and the employees and all of us in the room into how to be more confident and creative in what any of us are trying to achieve in life?
I mean, part of me, it's like, don't let, I was watching a story the other day on the CEO of Snap, and he was talking about how when he first talked about his idea, everyone laughed at him, right? People told him it was a stupid idea, and don't ever, or there was a, I was reading about, I think there was the Science Fair winner, who's family and science teacher told her that she could never create. It was like a test for, I think, some cancer. And don't ever let anyone tell you that you can't do anything, right? Like, I think have a healthy disregard for the impossible, right? Is what I think. And I don't know. It sounds like, you know, apple pie and, you know, and sort of Pollyannish. But I mean, but it's, I think about those, like, if I can't remember the guy's name, the CEO of Snap, if he had like listened to his GSB, his Stanford colleagues, he wouldn't be like a millionaire now. He would never have started that, right? But he had an idea. And he wasn't going to let anyone tell him that it didn't make any sense. So it really comes down to like believing in yourself and believing in your ideas, I think.
Okay. Boy, there's so much knowledge being in the vernacular dropped here tonight. I certainly hope that you're picking some of this up. A healthy disregard for the impossible. I mean, that's just absolutely beautiful. So I hope students, you really understand the meaning behind that, a healthy disregard for the impossible. Mr. West.
How you guys doing today? My name is Kyrie West. I'm a graduating senior here at Morgan State University, business administration major. Dr. Wilson kind of took my question a little bit, but I have another question that kind of not piggybacks, but goes off of that. You guys talk about like the effect of social injustice internally, but growing up, I got to witness, or a lot of us in the room got to witness, like the massive growth of the power of influence by influencers on platforms like YouTube and even Facebook. So, in the light of social injustice within the last year and a half, 2 years, how do your respective companies focus on empowering those influencers who want to speak out about what's going on? Because most companies, especially large companies, they like to stay neutral. So.
And when you say influencers, what kind of people do you mean?
So like she mentioned, you mentioned like the YouTuber who makes millions of dollars, or with the Facebook, you know, Instagram. So there's like, you know, people who make a living based off of like just Instagram posts.
Right.
So that's what I mean in that light.
Well, I mean, I think that's how we do it, right? Is that we provide this platform that anyone can use. And if you think about before these platforms existed, you had to have a particular kind of access, which was only reserved for very few, right? How would you get your word out there if you didn't know the editor at the newspaper? And that meant that it was very elite and ordinary people, right? You talk about the African-American population that has been traditionally marginalized, didn't have that kind of access in volume. Now that a platform like Facebook exists, now that there is Facebook Live, now that there is Instagram, it gives the opportunity for every single person for free, right? I mean, imagine that volume of access. So now it's turned on you. Now what are you gonna do with that? What are you going to do with that access? What are you going to do with the fact that you can reach all of the people you want to reach? Do you have something to say? Do you have something to do which is going to bring value to your community? Because it's not any longer about not having access. So now you come with the substance, you come with the confidence to help our communities to do better because the platform is yours.
Thank you, guys.
Okay, last two questions.
Hi, ladies. Thank you so much for sacrificing your time to be with us here today. My name is Robin Williamson, and I'm a senior finance major here in the School of Business. And I kind of have two questions, but I'm trying to put it into one. There's no secret that the tech support industry is run by predominantly whites and Asians. And as drivers of your companies in diversity and inclusion, has there been any opportunities to explore in terms of funding undergraduate programs directly to help produce the type of employees that you guys are looking for, and also to mold them to fit the cultures? And also, being that a lot of millennials nowadays are trying to stamp themselves as entrepreneurs, there's been a threat to higher education. So I'm wondering, is that a potential opportunity to also recreate the inspiration or the desire to go and receive higher education, if that makes sense?
I feel like the president can speak about the threat to higher education more than we could. And so on the first part of your question, which is, would tech companies fund education programs? Again, all tech companies are not created equal. All don't have the same resources, but each of us does quite a bit in what would be considered the pipeline area. So we partner with colleges, we partner with schools, we partner with national organizations that are weak in us to try to help to drive those efforts. So those are going on and to different degrees. And for many of us, we post on, so I won't take your time here with it, but we post online a lot of those programs that we do. And you know that the engineering in residence program is one of those which occurs here at Morgan State, where we send engineers to teach, right? That is a kind of underwriting because it's the engineer's time and effort, and that has a cost to it. We also will do sort of joint efforts sometimes. Sometimes we do individual with different places. You know, we do some work with, which you do as well, with Maria Clowey, and you know, there are different efforts in this realm, certainly already underway. But the biggest thing I think is about having the students and faculty understand the type of skills we're looking for. Because you have good people in place to do that. It's just understanding, having that match happen with greater frequency, more efficiency.
One of the other things that we actually just announced sort of last week that we're gonna be doing. So in addition to sort of engineer in residence, we're going to be bringing some faculty from HBCUs to the Googleplex for 6 weeks to give them some experience in applied computer science that they can integrate into their curriculum. And again, that's sort of aligned with the kind of computer science scientists that sort of that Google is looking for. But it's like almost like a two-pronged strategy. We work with directly with the students and partner with the universities as Maxine said, but also helping sort of some of these faculty understand what it's like to be out in Silicon Valley. We think it could be actually really, really valuable as well.
Okay, last question from the audience.
Hello, good evening. My name is Michael McDonald. I'm a sophomore computer science major here from the Bahamas. This question is for both of the panelists. As diversity and inclusion expertise, do you see a growth in opportunities available for undergraduate international students in the tech world after graduation?
Yes. That's a visa issue.
Bring the executive order into this room.
We are happy to hire the talent, people who have the skills from wherever they come from. If we are based in this country, where right, we some have offices in other countries. So it really depends on whatever the visa regulations are in each of those countries.
I agree. We have a number of folks from international locations at Google, but it comes down to sort of visas. But it doesn't, where you come from doesn't matter. It's whether you have the skills.
Okay, I'm going to ask Maxine and Yolanda if they would take an opportunity to share any last-minute thoughts with the audience before I close it out and make a few comments.
Y'all are great.
That means that you're ready to hire half of the people here,
exactly,
right?
Exactly, no. Thank you for having us. It's been an absolute pleasure and really insightful and thoughtful questions, so thank you.
I do want to recognize actually a Googler who is in the audience. Morgan State University last year decided to participate in the Google in Residence program. And so Gunzi, he's been here on our faculty for a year teaching in the computer science department. But he is a Google in Residence scholar with us, and we're very, very pleased to have this relationship established already with Google. And we are very excited, Maxine, about our ongoing conversations with Facebook, and we look forward to where that would take us as well. I do want you to know that this is the beginning of a dialogue that will continue tomorrow. There are three things that will be happening tomorrow, and I want you to jot these down and take full advantage of this opportunity. On tomorrow, we will continue this discussion here at Morgan on careers at both Facebook and Google. And so from 11:30 until 1 o'clock here in the business building, there will be a focus on technical careers, quote, the hard thing about the simple thing. And so if you're interested in finding out about technical careers at either Google or Facebook, assembled here in the auditorium tomorrow from 11:30 until 1 o'clock. Then At same time, from 11:30 until 1 o'clock, for those individuals who are in non-STEM disciplines, and you're interested in exploring careers at Facebook or Google, you can meet in room 112 here in the business building as well to talk about what those opportunities are. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving another round of applause to Maxine and to Yolanda. And thank you. Thank you very much. You guys were fantastic. And we have just a couple of tokens for you. And so we know that, you know, both of you have these unbelievably terrific campuses. And so on those days when they have the Show Your University Colors, we don't want any Stanford and we any Yale. And so we want that true university color to show. And so we want to present, first of all, both of you with a memento from Oregon.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Okay.